Good morning from a very sunny morning here in Hong Kong. Today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to review this book, New Business Models for the Knowledge Economy, and it's written by three academics in the Netherlands. Now, I stumbled across this book by complete accident when I was looking for books on my knowledge management assignment in my master's. Now, I thought this was going to be very academic-y and that I was just going to pick up a thing or two for it. Great reference to add in and so on, whereas instead, actually, it has taken me 18 months to read this properly, even though there's 132 pages in it. It's not that I'm a slow reader, it's just that it's given me an awful lot to think about. And yesterday, on a Sunday afternoon in Hong Kong Park, I did get to the end of it, and all it made me want to do was to go back and start again and actually really identify key pieces of learning out of it, which is what I want to share with you today. So, first and foremost, there's three key things that I wanted to talk to you about, which I think could be very, very useful for you if you are somebody who is considering how you build your business model. But more specifically than that, I think this book is excellent if you are trying to discern things that aren't taught generally in whether it's a Start Your Own Business course or whether it is those big leadership training courses, etc. There's three things in here that I had not heard of before, really and truly had not heard of before. And I wanted to share them with you. So the first one, and this one has probably been the most impactful for me, is the theory of reciprocal value. Now, again, some of this is quite textbooky, but when you apply it, it's very, very real world. So reciprocal value is all about, if you think about it, okay, generally when I would say to you, what is your business model? I'm also asking, how do you charge in such a way that you can make money? Okay, that's generally the way we think a business model is. But this looks at things differently. It says, okay, if I am going to create value for you, which we're going to assume that I do, if I don't do that, you're not going to buy from me in the first place. How else do people pay for that apart from with money? Okay, so for example, I am, as you know, co-founder of Savvy Teen Academy. So we provide a summer camp for teenagers focusing on careers, communication, and confidence. And we provide that for our teenagers and then parents or sponsors or aunties and uncles pay for it to send their teenagers along. And there is value there. But what else is there? How else, what other value are our customers giving to us at Savvy Teen Academy? So the way reciprocal value would train you to think is, number one, it gives you market research. The fact that they're willing to buy from you shows that there's an interest in this. But when people don't buy from you, maybe it is because of the lack of suitability of the timing. Maybe it is that they are interested in one particular area of the course, maybe career guidance, and they would prefer to go to somebody directly for career mentoring, for example. Maybe it is that they're solely interested in public speaking, and since they're interested in public speaking, they're willing to pay for the whole program to get that piece of it. So there's a lot of market research comes from engaging with your buyers and your non-buyers. Secondly, a lot of our parents delightfully have recommended us to other people. So therefore, when they buy from us, they're also willing to be advocates for Savvy Teen Academy as well, as are our students who have given us some really wonderful testimonials over the years. And also, when our teenagers come along, I've told a lot of you about this already. When our teenagers do come along to us, in July, they share a lot of their views. So whether it is about Snapchat or whether it is about how they see employers of tomorrow or how they feel society reflects on them, etc. So rather than simply think a business model is just about the money that you receive in exchange for the value that you give, what this book has taught me to do is to look at many of the other ways in which we are getting value from reciprocal value from our customers as well. So let me give you an example of here. Okay, so I'm over here at the moment, here in Hong Kong. I was in Shanghai last weekend for 4 days up working with other people as well. So am I just here with a view to selling aspects of our business? And I could look at it like that, and I could solely measure the value of the trip doing that. However, this book again has taught me to think differently. Because while I'm here, I'm also gathering those types of insights that you simply can't get from Google, or even that you can't just get from people who have traveled over here. It's talking to people who are living here, both Irish and Hong Kong and Chinese. It's talking to local people here. It's talking to those people here who have views about the way in which Europe is working, or the way in which they feel about doing business with the Irish. And all of that feeds into our training business, and it feeds into our Savvy Teen Academy. Because let's just say, in July, I will meet people who probably will ask me about what it's like to study abroad, or maybe what it's like to get an internship in China and so on. And now I have far, not alone have I insights, but I actually have connectivity that I can direct them accordingly with. So therefore, there's actually quite a lot of reciprocal value that I can glean from being here. I've met many of the people from Team Ireland. Team Ireland would be Enterprise Ireland, or be a Tourism Ireland, etc. So I have those contacts. And of course, what has also happened is that from being here, people here have referred me to people in other countries, including Ireland. So therefore, China and Hong Kong are already directing business to us at home. So that is the whole idea of reciprocal value. Now, much of this book is built on that. It's built on looking at the business models, each of the three business models that it outlines. It really hones in on what reciprocal value is there and how that reciprocal value can then move it around and move that value into other areas also. Now, the second thing I want to talk about is something that is very close to a Chinese heart, and that is, some of you will have heard, if you've ever even attended a presentation or spoke to a person doing business in here in China, you will hear about a term called Guangqi. And that is the whole idea of businesses built on relationships. And that's the way business is done in the East. And that term you will hear over and over and over and over and over again here in China. Now, the thing is, if you think about it, if business is built on relationships, well then ultimately business is based on trust. Now, if we think of that further again, what really is trust? And more importantly, how is trust created? So that is one of the other things that's done in this book, is that they decipher and discern what consists of trust. And they do this in a certain way relating to business modeling, because one of their business models in here, called the innovator model, is all about shared governance and enabling various different parties who aren't all shared or don't all work together in the one entity, how they can work together in a trusted way. So here's the five elements of trust. Consistency over time, which means that you do what you say you're going to do, and you're going to do it with reliability and predictability. Two is integrity, is that there's coherence in words and deeds. So what you say you will do is equally followed up with deeds. And they're not the same thing. So integrity is, if you say something that I can believe in you, consistency over time is that I can do that consistently over time. Communication and openness is that we don't hide information from each other, is that instead we're open with each other. And also, if there's feedback to be shared that isn't always comfortable, that we know that we will do that directly with each other, as opposed to going behind someone's back or not at all and carrying it out in a passive aggressive way. Number four is genuine care and attention towards each other. I think that speaks for itself. And five is shared governance, is that we know that if something goes right, that it will be rewarded. And if it goes wrong, that there will be feedback loops there for that information to be shared in such a way that is the same for everybody. And if you think about it, if we take those five aspects, right, let's take those five aspects of trust and think about that in terms of doing business in a new country, which I'm now doing. Now, on my way to doing, we're not doing business here yet, but on the way. So if you think about that, if I take those five principles, and while they may seem obvious when they're explained, if you think of every single aspect of the way in which we work with our new customers and new stakeholders and new suppliers and new everything here, if I take those five principles and with each transaction, whether it's an email, whether it is an action, whether it's a meeting, whether it's a call, whether it's a proposal, whether it's a contract, whether it's a business deal, and I keep those five right in place, that is how I can build Guangqi. That is how I can do it. Now, of course, many of us on this page are Irish, and therefore we know that we have an Irish advantage, which is that we've charm and we have a lot of people around the world, and that we have got the Irish advantage, which is those entities around Ireland House who can help us along the way. All of those are all there too. Of course, I need to bring those to the fore. And of course, being Irish and building trust isn't going to be enough. We also need a product that this market wants. And that is, of course, why I have spent, this is my third trip here in 5 months. So What I'm out here is to see what does the market want and what we're offering, is it of relevance to them? Is it something that they're willing to pay for? Is it something that they're willing to buy into, etc.? So of course, we need to have that also. And that of course is what we're working at. So when you put all of those three things together, I've got the reciprocal value of the market research, I've got the product and the service that I'm constantly evaluating to see, is this what the market wants out here? And how do I tweak it accordingly? Which has been a complete work in progress for every moment that I've been here, as well as thinking about how can I build that trust in, that's absolutely key. The last thing that I really took out of this, this book here, New Business Models for the Knowledge Economy, is generally when we are thinking about our market, we think in three areas. We think demographically, so men and women between a certain age. Savvy Teen Academy, focusing on careers, communication and confidence for teenagers between 15 to 18, typically who are going into fifth and sixth year. Okay, that's one way I could look at it. Secondly, we think about it geographically. So businesses who are operating here in Hong Kong and China that want to upskill their people here locally in how to do business in Europe could be, for example, a geographical target market that here at Hayes Cullerton that we would be targeting here in Hong Kong and China. Okay, and the other way we can do it is psychographically. So we might also say, well, people who are interested, I'll give you an example. I see Deirdre McGlone from Harvey's Point has just joined. Good morning, Deirdre. So for example, give you a way in which I worked with Deirdre and a number of her colleagues a while ago. So last September, I spoke for the Donegal Women in Business Network, and fantastic event that was held in Deirdre's new conference centre at Harvey's Point. So psychographically, that is a group of women in business in Donegal and the surrounding areas who are particularly interested in learning more about how to do business, in want to be inspired by a range of different speakers who were there, including Magella O'Donnell, and they had a range of other fantastic speakers. Check out their Facebook page. They're constantly evolving all the time. And there are also people who are interested in networking with each other. They had 150 women in that room today. Sorry, in that room that day, who are interested in networking with each other. So there are three psychographic elements they're looking for: learning, inspiration, and networking. Now, that's generally the way, and it's a very useful way, right? Very, very effective way to characterize or categorize your target market. However, this book gives you an additional way, which is, how about if we actually categorized our market in terms of what they value? So let's not necessarily think about where they are. Let's not think about what age they are. And let's not think about the state of mind that they're in and what specifically, how that relates to the product that we're offering. But instead, let's think about what do they value. So I read a fantastic article a couple of months ago in the Harvard Business Review around the 30 elements that consumers truly value. Okay, so some of us value things like connectivity. We want to feel connected to other people. That's why we form part of communities. Some of us want to save money. Okay, I will move utility provider from A to B when I realize that I can save money. Some of us will do something when we want to make money, obviously. Any of us who are entrepreneurs, we want to do that. Some of us want to feel part of something greater than ourselves, which is transcendence. So I want to be part of a much bigger entity, for example, the Global Irish. I'm a really passionate member of the Irish diaspora. Even though I live in Dublin and I travel regularly, I still feel part of the Global Irish diaspora, and I'm very passionate about helping the Global Irish community into furthering what it wants to do. So therefore, I'm part of the Irish International Business Network, for example. I'm willing to give my time, which has a value, like all of yours does, to IIBN in a voluntary capacity because I feel passionate about that. So there are values that we have. So whether it's convenience, it's connectivity, it's transcendence, or many, many other different things. And wouldn't it be a very different approach if actually we categorized our business modeling, we categorize the people who buy from us in such a way that it actually hones in really and truly focuses in on the way in which people value what we offer. And then from there, take demographic, psychographic, and geographic. Because if we did that, well, then we probably would have a far greater sense of what that person wants, how to serve them. And then from there, we could build our business models accordingly. So in summary, I found this book very useful. It is going to be on my bookshelf at home for a very, very, very long time. It's called New Business Models for the Knowledge Economy. And just, by the way, just to give you a very quick summary of what the three are. So the first one is called The Chameleon. The second one is called The Innovator, and the third one is called The Foyer Business Models. All very, very useful. The reason that I didn't elaborate specifically on them is that they're all honing in on a specific mindset that one of you a percentage of you would have, whereas the other three that I picked up on, namely the value of reciprocal value and how that has changed my mindset in terms of every interaction that I do, discerning and really putting together the principles of trust, and how that particularly is a value when you're doing business with new and existing contacts, but particularly new contacts and in a new market, particularly with a new product, it becomes all the more relevant. And the third thing is segregating your market in terms of what they value first, and then demographically, psychographically, and geographically. So on that case, from a very sunny morning here in Hong Kong, I'm going to wish you all the very best. Would you believe I'm now going to go to watch dragon boating down here in the harbour. That is something that, because it's a public holiday here in Hong Kong, that is something that has been done, it's a tradition for thousands of years. So I'm going to meet a number of people and we're going to go and watch that. And when I come back here, this has just been landed on my desk, South China Morning Post. So this evening, I'm going to realise what happened in South China this morning. So thank you all so much indeed. Thank you for joining me right here this morning. And to each and every one of you, have a truly, truly, truly fantastic week. Thank you very much and goodbye.